Thank you for being with us tonight. This meeting has been brought to you in part by...
Let Grand Forks International Airport help you start your next vacation off on the right foot. Grand Forks International Airport offers flights to the sunny destinations of Orlando, Las Vegas, and Phoenix on Allegiant, and connections anywhere in the world through Minneapolis-St. Paul on Delta. Forget the hassle of long drives, parking nightmares, and stressful check-ins. The convenience of flying locally means less headaches and more time for you. Grand Forks International Airport, your airport, simply grand.
What's up? Sure, be right there.
When a ringtone comes between you and your day off, at least there's satisfaction in knowing that while you're away, you can keep the best brand name tools at your fingertips. Like Honda and Alcoa. Not to mention, of course, DeWalt. That way, work gets done faster, and what you left behind doesn't have long to wait. Load up today at the guaranteed lowest price, only at Home of Economy.
You know what we think a lot about? Energy. Clean energy. Smart energy. New energy. All kinds of energy. But you know, the safe kind. That's why at Xcel Energy, we're using future stuff like drones, AI, and virtual reality to make the future of energy cleaner, less expensive, and, you guessed it, safer. For you, for us, for everyone.
Work. There's all kinds. There's the work we do in the morning. The work we do in the dead of night. Problem-solving, world-changing, mind-bending hard work. It's what drives us. To lead the way, unwilling to quit. Because the work we do, it's bigger than us. It's work worth doing.
Live it up. Every day you wake up singing, turn it up. The party's just beginning.
Good evening. Welcome to beautiful downtown Grand Forks, the home of the University of North Dakota. This is the time and place for the Committee of the Whole meeting. Begin with a welcome and roll call, please.
Weigel?
Here.
Doppler? Weber?
Here.
Mock?
Here.
Marshall?
Here.
Sandy?
Here. I'm going to go straight.
Here.
Veen?
Here.
All right. Katie, are you on the phone?
I am.
Okay, thank you.
Everyone's here. Very good. Begin with item 2.1, the 2020 Flood Action Planning Update. Mr. Phelan.
Councilmember Weber and members of City Council, I'm going to team up with Al Grasser, City Engineer, and John Bernstrom is going to come in. We're just going to give you a kind of before all the things start transpiring this spring, what we're going to do and how things work, and give you a primer and then get whatever feedback that you need from that. So, you know, just as background, Al's going to show a map of the concept of what our flood protection project is. And really, if most times, you know, this might be more significant flooding, so you may want to know who does what. We have about 12 flood stations. We have several gates and valves and those sorts of things. And our Water Works department does that, and that's led by Melanie. And so you'll see a team of wastewater, stormwater, and water distribution employees working across the organization, supporting one another, at the same time doing some of their regular jobs at that point in time. So it's a really good team on that side doing that. You'll see Public Works, and Public Works represents street sanitation, central garage. They do a lot of the closures. And so when we put up the stop logs and along all the closures, I think we have about 12 closures. We have three bridges, obviously. We have two rail crossings that they work with. So while they do their regular jobs, the street department's doing a lot of those activities within the Public Works Department. Again, we're sharing resources across. So it's really good to see those two groups working that action plan. Al Grasser and his department, they kind of choreograph the flood action plans of all that we do. And so we have meetings. And so it's a really nice blend of City Hall folks, master planning, strategic planning, and then our crews in Water Works and Public Works, for example, making things happen. And you have such a dedicated, wonderful crew, and they really shine during times like this. In addition, because, for instance, Councilmember Marshall, in your ward, we have Shady Ridge and we have Adams, so we have to do some more maneuvering over there, and now it's annexed into the city. So our public safety crews help with that emergency response, because, you know, that's going to get blocked off, and there's some other maneuvers that we have in there. So you'll see Chiefs Nelson and Lorenz are working in that area with their crews doing those sorts of things. So they're supporting the operation. Then on the communication side, you have our public information office that's kind of getting the word out, hearing from people. And then we have emergency management is also a really good communication coordination device for all of us. So that's kind of how the whole team comes together. It really is a good time because people are working so hard, and you may not see that day to day, but people are really dedicated to the City of Grand Forks, and they'll run through a wall to save and do anything for the City of Grand Forks. So I want to give you a background on that. The other thing, probably even maybe as soon as next week at the City Council meeting, we'll have to declare an emergency so that we can open up ourselves to resources from the state or the federal government. And there's going to be a meeting tomorrow evening at 5:30 right in this location, where we'll have state and federal agencies going through, and we'll be attending too, and it's an open meeting, so many of us may be there. But we'll probably like to do that sooner rather than later, when Al's going to show you numbers that we're probably going to have a top five flood here in Grand Forks, to getting ready for all that. So I would say, Al, we need to talk about two policy matters, and we don't need to decide those tonight, and one of which we may not even have to do anything. But number one, in the Shady Ridge area, we did more in that area than in Shady Ridge, and I'll call it the Adams Drive, the wet side of the levee. We did more in that area just to make sure everything was okay, and thankfully last spring the water didn't come up as high as we anticipated. But we should have some conversations about what you want us to do in that area. And when we first decided to get into this thing, we were going to kind of be more hands off, but as time has gone by, we've gotten more and more involved. So we should probably have some conversations with you, Councilmember Marshall. I know we had a really good meeting on that last spring, so we'll probably do that sooner rather than later. And the other thing is, Al was telling me in 2009 we had to put some clay on the levee in around Lincoln area. We may or may not have to do that, but those are two City Council items we probably should engage with that. So with that, Al's going to give you some of the numbers. And then really we're looking for feedback to what we do well, what you'd like to see. And it's sooner rather than later, and so we can adapt to whatever game plan you would like to see from us.
Hey, thank you, Todd.
All right, we'll just jump right into it here. Get the clicker. Again, this is the flood action meeting. Apologize, the size of this is such that you can't really read it very well, but this is our flood perimeter map. Basic reference point we've been using for a number of years. This one is a fairly detailed map, but I'll just kind of go over some of the basic components of our flood protection system. You'll see here in red along the easterly boundary of the city, there is essentially a series of flood walls and levees, earthen levees. There's a few MSE walls that are kind of some block type walls, half levee and half wall kind of things you see downtown. As Mr. Phelan mentioned, there's a series of pumping stations, because when the river comes up, we have to shut the gates, and then we start to pump any interior water that then is trying to go to the river and can't anymore because the water is too high. Those have electrical backup energy, and a lot of them are tied in with sanitary lift stations at this point too, so they have some backup power capacity. Again, there's some other gates that just get closed. I talked about the stop log structures that the street department would be putting in. You've seen those on Demers Avenue occasionally, those metal beams, and stack them up again to close those openings up in anticipation of the high water. There's a few up and overs out in there, where the Shady Ridge area is one where you actually, there's a road that goes up and over the top of the levee and down, so there's no stop logs and things in there. So there's a lot of different features. I won't go over any of those really anymore at this point in time. The other one of the components then is this south end. This is Merrifield Road down here, and that's what we call the tieback levee. That's the improvement in road raise that keeps the river from trying to get around us from the south. Likewise, there's also an English Coulee diversion ditch. In this part of the world, the overland flooding goes from southwest to northeast, and the English Coulee is a major tributary drainage basin that comes right through town, and basically the Corps couldn't build a pump station large enough to just handle those flows. So as part of this flood protection project, they diverted, they intercept and divert a lot of the overland water. And then what's left interior to the city goes to a pump station on the north end of town based on the English Coulee. Creatively enough, we call it the English Coulee Pump Station. So just a point of note, this is actually a second diversion. There's a diversion that's farther west and a holding dry dam. So there's been a long history of flooding here in the rural area and that water rolling into town. And so this is actually a second component of overland flow interception for the city. Interstate runs here. That's basically the layout. You know, there's 20 some miles, I think, of walls and levees, and then we've got, again, the diversion channel. Part of this diversion channel up here is actually also a tieback levee. It was designed, the elevation of the river was controlling that elevation as opposed to the elevation it took to run the water in the channel. Probably a piece of trivia you didn't need to know. just again of note, you know, when we talk about the bridge closures and things when we do our flood fights, you know, the first bridges that start to close are the Sorley and the Point, and they both go down kind of in the mid-40s is when those go down. The exact trigger depends upon how the rate of rise of the water and other issues that are going on. The Kennedy is kind of in the low 50s. And again, it depends on the year. If we're near crest, what happened, you know, may or may not happen in there. Somebody may, you know, the Minnesota DOT may try to protect that and keep it open a little longer than it might otherwise occur on its just natural state. But that road was, the lowest point on that road was raised here a couple years ago compared to 2009 and obviously 97. Any questions? I don't know if I should stop in between, but any questions on that? The map is kind of what the map is. This is the information that just came out from the National Weather Service last week, and it's their probabilistic forecast simulation. And of interest, you know, this is certainly a higher level of flood outlook than we have seen in the recent past. We've noted on here the design water elevation of the flood protection project. We spent so many years talking about 60 feet. I think everybody thinks, well, 60 feet, we're good to 60 feet. Well, that's the top of the levee. That's not where you need to be or want to be. The flood protection was designed for 57 feet water elevation with what they call risk and uncertainty. We generally call it freeboard, but it's called risk and uncertainty. And for good reason, there's a lot of uncertainty in exactly where the water level is going to be. The water is measured at a gauge downtown, basically by the Sorley Bridge. But what that water elevation does at distances away from that is something that's done by computers and calculations and things like that. And there's always some uncertainty that goes along with that, in addition to some of the uncertainty that the National Weather Service has even in some of their numbers. So again, as Mr. Phelan mentioned, we do need to, we are seeing some small levels of probability exceeding the top of the levee at this point in time. We're gonna wanna pay very, very close attention to that. And that gets to be a difficult decision relative to a very low probability event with a very, very high risk, high impact. And maybe just a word of note, you know, last year, this is the first year that we're actually getting this level this early. Usually this kind of product comes out in February. The Weather Service is kind of pushing it another month to give everybody forewarning because they see the situation as it's developing now. Last year, some of those first probabilistic forecasts that we received put us at certain locations, and by the time we got done with our storm events in February, we basically were near about the 30 percentile level last year. I don't know if that's any relevant particular information. It just shows how it can change. But basically what goes into this thing is the Weather Service presentations. We had a record wet year last year. We had a record wet fall last year. The late fall rains that we had were still in the process of evacuating the fields and ditches and rivers when they froze up this winter. We've already had snowfall amounts exceeding what a normal winter would be already to date. Those are some of the things that are going into this probabilistic outlook that they have. I will note the one thing that they say we are better at than normal is the frost. There's not much frost in the ground. I don't take a lot of comfort on that because what's not frost is basically mud. So it's not gonna have a lot of ability to absorb. That's not the Weather Service forecast, that's my commentary. So maybe just a word about what this forecast looks like. I'm gonna try to oversimplify something that I can't necessarily, don't understand 100% myself, all the mathematics and statistics that goes into these things. But if you think about the 50% number, which is often referenced in news conferences and things like that, that's basically this upper number tries to take into account some of our current conditions that we have with the wet ground and things like that. 50% would be 50% of exceeding that or 50% being lower than that. You can think about they're higher numbers, but they're lower elevations. 99% chance that you're gonna be at least, 41 feet. And for that to occur in simplistic terms, I mean, we get very, very little precipitation. We have perhaps an early and a very, very, very favorable melt. Okay. The upper end here where we get into these really high numbers would reflect actual climate in which we have a late frost, we have a above normal precipitation between now and then, and probably throw a rainfall event on top of the melt. That would get us into. So the combination of all those things happening are relatively low. And so that's why you see those at like a 1% and a 2% probability level. We're going to get another one of these outlooks on February 13th is the date that I wrote down. And we'll see what changes. We have seen in the past these things do change because conditions will change in the intervening time between when they produced one product and they make the next. And there'll be a series of those in February and March. And basically, usually by the time they get towards the end of March, they quit doing the probabilistic thing. And then they hopefully will start getting into actually giving us more of a numeric. You probably remember last year, you'd start to see something that has a curve on it. You know, and it says, you know, today's Monday and the crest is on Friday, and you can see that it's going to go up another 2 feet. Sorry, I don't have a picture of that one, but if you can picture what that, you know, that gets us when they have much more data once water starts getting into the system and their computer models can handle, you know, what's going on there. So that's kind of how that whole situation will set up. Mr. Phelan made a good discussion about some of the points we're probably going to need to talk about this year. We're going to have to pay a lot of attention to what goes on here, and do we trigger some sort of actions based on that. Those are going to be tough policy decisions to make. So maybe just a quick overview, where are we at now? You know, what's staff doing, what's going on? You will see, I think, the next go around to the committee of the whole, we actually will have the annual project that we bid equipment and material out for a flood fight. And we do that on a annual basis. We're doing that this year too. So that sets the stage for us to line up contractors based on low bids and advertising and all those legal things that we need to make sure all happen. We're also inventorying availability of local stockpiles of clay and crushed concrete, things like that. Mr. Phelan mentioned there's a flood preparedness presentation going on tomorrow right here at City Council at 5:30, driven primarily by the state and federal government about resources and things that are available to individuals and to other entities. We do have, if you recall, when we did the flood protection project, we added an extra 3 feet to the flood walls with the idea that we had the potential to add clay on top of the levees. But we learned in 97 a wall is a wall, and it's very, very hard to get squeak much out of that just for various reasons. And so we'll probably be brushing off our 3-foot flood fight document to take a look at that and maybe look at the logistics. In general, we have a plan that we can top off another 3 feet. The problem is it's about, I'm going to call it about a 3-week implementation process. So to get it started and finished when you need it, you got to start it way before you have a solid number. And the discussion in 2009, when we did it last time in the Lincoln area, for instance, you have a levee that's 20 plus feet tall. If you wait until the ground starts to thaw and that gets slippery and slimy, you probably can't even get up there with crawler or track even equipment. And so sometimes that went into part of the decision making at that time about doing an early start, because when it's frozen, you can get on it with equipment. It's much easier to maneuver. Other areas where the levees maybe aren't quite so tall, that's maybe not quite as big of a logistical item, but there's a couple spots where we have some pretty tall levees. I think I'll quit on that note, at least on most of this. I'm going to note that there are part of the presentation you're going to see tomorrow is going to be a discussion on flood insurance. I recommend people buy flood insurance. I recommend that any time of the year, all the time when we have. I carry it myself, so I'm not a hypocrite. It's just a good thing to have, be it a fall flood, be it a rainfall event flood like we had, or something here from the river. So just want to be on record with that. And after that, I will introduce Mr. Bernstrom, that's going to talk a bit about some of the information we have on the city website, things like that. In the meantime, till he's able to get up here, you know, we have any questions on, I threw a lot at you here tonight.
If I may quickly, First of all, the probability chart that we're looking at, there's some scary information in the top right corner, but that's in the area of a 1 or 2% probability.
Correct.
The numbers we're looking at on the far left, these are with current projections, current probabilities, those are the more likely with the current conditions.
Well, these are exceedance percentages. So on the bottom end there, the lowest number there, I'll call it 42. There's very, very few scenarios in which the flooding will get less than that. All the likelihoods are greater than 99% or 98.5% are all predicted to be higher than that. What they do is they do a series of runs of past flooding events and situations. They run a, whatever, I think they call it a spaghetti run of all the data that they've got, and they start formulating. So again, it's important to understand this is an exceedance probability chart. The probabilities I generally start looking at early on is about the 30 percentile. It just happens to be that that's about where last year's flood ended up. For various reasons, I think the 30 is probably the lower end in my mind that I would be thinking about at this point. It might be higher. The Weather Service is predicting a cold, wet spring. So what that does is that takes you somewhere from 50% and starts moving you up this curve. And what that magic number will be, I'm not exactly sure. Again, we'll have to pay a lot of attention to the next outlook that comes out. But clearly 50% is a non-starter in my mind when I look at this. 50%, there's a 30% here is about 50 feet, maybe a tish over. So our design, if you look at our design elevation line here, project that down, you're somewhere in that 3%-ish range or something like that, hitting the chance of exceeding the design event at this point in time. But again, a lot of it's going to depend on what kind of precip and things we get.
And of course, this is based upon the worst of the flood. Another thing that we have to deal with is the duration of the flood, yep. Which has a long-term impact as well. The current ice thickness, my understanding is that we're kind of record low in terms of thickness of the ice. How does that play out in something like this?
You know, that should be a favorable outcome in where the water ends up. In Grand Forks, it's not a, well, I got to be careful how I say it. It's a big player when the ice is on there. Usually when we get to the really high events, the river ice is off, and so it ends up being not quite as big of an issue. The advantage of it is it gets the ice off quicker. I think between the higher base flows that we've been running all fall and winter, water in motion tends not to freeze, okay? And we've had a pretty fair amount of snowfall, so you kind of insulate that ice, and then you know, you keep it kind of from freezing up on the bottom to a degree. You keep that thickness. That's definitely a benefit. And hopefully that goes, you know, actually where we see some of the ice problems is if they jam up on a big structure, say the Sorley Bridge or Kennedy or the railroad bridge, something like that. Even as far north as Oslo, and Oslo has a tendency that there's a bridge there that catches an awful lot of ice. We can see those effects all the way back here. But hopefully that is a one of the things in the plus column relative to keeping the flood down is the thinner layer of ice.
A sobering report. Any further questions or comments from committee members?
Now, do you know, is the Weather Service coming for the widespread ice sheets out on the river in terms of how that might affect getting the ice hung up?
I think the question is
repeating the question. Thanks.
Question is the Weather Service taking into account some of the basically the frozen ice sheets that are already out there in the field? And I'm not going to pretend that I know the answer exactly to that. I think the answer is that the they're recognizing that there's a lot of frozen water out there yet, be it in snow or be it in ice. Ice may or may not have an impact relative to the culverts being able to get the water to the river, you know, on the overland flow. But I don't think their modeling is specific enough to really capture that nuance. I mean, it's there, but it's not, I think, there as a discrete item.
Very good. Mr. Bernstrom.
Well, now that you've heard the report, I get to be the one who tells the story. So how we did things last year, we had from a communication standpoint during last year's spring flood fight, we had a pretty successful plan that worked out pretty well for getting information out on what the city was doing. Also working with Grand Forks County as far as flood impacts out in the county, specifically roads open, stuff like that. So we're going to do something very similar coming up this spring as well. This is our flood fight page. You can find it at grandforksgov.com/flood. For the 30 or 40 or so people on Facebook, I'll post that link in comments. So grandforksgov.com/flood. Here's the information on the page right now. Again, we are going to treat this website, this web page, as this is going to catch everything. So any public notices that go out regarding flood fighting, any meetings that go out regarding flood fight, is all going to be congregated right here. As we get more into the action plan itself, maybe some of these buttons at the top of the page may change depending on the scenarios we're working in. They may have road closure information. Not sure what may happen in the county as far as sandbags. We'll have that information on there as well. But as of right now, that's not on there. And probably as right now, the best thing that will happen is, or the thing to visit this page for, is at the very bottom, you can sign up. So all these notifications that do go out, or situation reports, road closures, that we put out as notices, you can sign up and get those notices on this website, and you'll get an email as those go out. Last year, we had 164 email addresses sign up to receive those notifications. They received a bunch of emails. We ended up sending out over 6,000 emails. Now, that's each email is multiplied several times. I don't want to make it sound like I was sending that many. And we can see we sent out nearly 20 different notifications. This website itself was our most viewed page in 2019 with just over 46,000 page views. Of course, most of those coming in March and April of last year. So that is how we'll get the word out. It is a, we'll use the term, it's a smart page. It is adaptable, as I'll sit here and shrink it up, adaptable for the size of device you're using. So we did notice it last year that most of the users of this page were on a phone. So we're able to track that. Any questions of how we hope to communicate?
Yes, Mr. Bernstrom, I understand that there are three actual public meetings this week. There's the one tomorrow night at 5:30 and then an additional two public meetings. Can you tell us about those and if they're different than the one tomorrow night or?
Sure. Yes, they are different. Tomorrow it is the state offices, Water Commission, Corps of Engineers, insurance commissioners is coming, emergency services, as they're doing a tour on the state, getting prepared for spring flooding statewide. On Thursday, coordinated through our emergency management office, they're actually working with a local insurance agent, and it's just an informational seminar on flood insurance, what it does cover, what it doesn't cover, questions you may need to ask your insurance agent. So that's going to be Thursday at noon right here in the city council chambers. There'll be another one of those as well next Tuesday in the evening at the Alaris Center. Again, you will find, in fact, I will pull it up right now. We have it right here. They had one last week at the Alaris Center. I understand it was attended very well, a full room. Again, it's not, you can't go there and buy flood insurance, but you can get information as far as what it covers. It can sometimes be a complicated program. So those are the public meetings that are coming up here in about the next 8 days.
Thank you.
Important question. Thanks. Anything else? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item 2.2.
Sole source request, Rescue One connector bolt package.
Chief Lorenz.
Good evening, Councilman Weber, members of the council. In the 2020 budget, approved budget, there was allocated funds for the replacement of a boat for the fire department. And what you have in front of you is a sole source procurement request for a Rescue One connector boat to replace a 1975 model boat currently in possession by the department. Staff researched this boat and felt it was a very good fit for the department, and it's a make and style that is very versatile, and the advancements are significant compared to the one that's 45 years old. It's a flat bottom boat designed for rescue operation, but it also dual purposes for the fire department as a vessel to deploy what we call absorbent booms into the river should we had some type of leak, or not just the river, any water for that matter that we could launch it into. It sits on a trailer like a normal boat, but it's very stable and it's very user friendly, and it's the sheriff's office actually uses two older models of this boat and have been very happy with it. As you see in the documentation in front of you, they highly recommend it. It's built in Alabama. The owner has the patent on this vessel, and the distributor's out of Michigan. So that is why the request is in front of you.
Any questions or comments?
I move approval.
I have a motion from Mr. Campbell, second from Ms. Mock.
And just a question. What's would be a projected delivery date for this boat? Would we have it in time for the flood?
That's kind of what I'm hoping for. We're looking at about a 60-day delivery, so we're going to be very close, and I'm going to push hard to get it here in time. We even have an offer to drive down and get it, so that might happen.
Any further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Okay,
aye.
I think
that's it. We have ayes. Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
Mr. Sandy, was that a vote of approval or opposition?
No. I just wanted to be later than everyone else.
Very good. motion passes. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Lorenz. Item 2.3.
Supplemental resolution relating to $5,175,000 wastewater and sales tax revenue bond series 2016 and $7,155,000 refunding improvement bond series 2016.
Ms. Dorstein.
Thank you. Mr. Weber, members of the committee, this item is very procedural for you tonight. This is in regards to the $15 million Bank of North Dakota loan that we had previously applied for and was authorized. When we were able to take advantage of this, if you remember, it came with favorable terms of 2% 30-year financing that we were able to use for much of our underground infrastructure in our water treatment plant area. What comes before you tonight then is when we did borrow these funds, although it was $15 million in total, it had to be separated into three separate loans as per the funding source, knowing that in the end we would just have to do a little reallocation and paperwork at the end when all the numbers came in. So what this is tonight is just that supplemental resolution and amended and restated loan agreement to do shifting between two of those three loans, but still in total is still the $15
million. Very good.
Correct. So what we'd be looking for is approval of the resolution and the loan agreement.
I have a motion from Ms. Marshall, seconded by Ms. Mock. Any further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Item 2.4. Mr. Karanko.
Good evening, Mr. Weber and members of the council. What you have before you is a reconstruction project for South 12th Street from 17th Avenue South to Park Drive. Currently, this local street is in relatively poor condition, and it's got poor drainage as well. And in looking at this road that was constructed in 1957 or thereabouts, it doesn't really appear that this road could be rehabilitated, which is why we were recommending it be reconstructed at this time. Overall, this road acts as a rearage road for a number of businesses along the Washington Street corridor. And there are a number of back driveway access or pavement in the berm area on the west side. And so we'd be looking at removing and replacing that pavement of the road, as well as the pavement for those businesses as well. That way then we can tie into it appropriately. With the poor drainage condition of this road, we're also looking at installing some additional catch basins to address that drainage issue, as well as installing streetlights along this local street. With that, staff is recommending approval of the engineer's report, create the special assessment district, and directing the engineering department to prepare plans and specs and advertise for construction of this project.
Got a motion from Ms. Marshall, second from Mr. Weigel. Any further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Item 2.5.
Plans and specifications for project number 8122-2020 asphalt street repairs.
Good evening, Councilman Weber, members of the council. This project consists of the annual maintenance project for the asphalt street along with two bike path extensions. The bike path projects extend the bike path along the north side of 62nd Avenue from Belmont Road to Cottonwood Street and along 62nd Avenue from Kingsview Drive to Magnolia Drive. Funding for the annual maintenance portion of the project will come from the minor street repairs shown in the street and infrastructure budget and the targeted dollar amount of $60,000. Funding for the bike paths will come from the bike path maintenance shown in the street and infrastructure budget and has a budgeted amount of $100,000. Current project estimates are at $153,000 for the project. Project is scheduled to bid on February 18th, and staff would recommend approval of plans and specifications for City Project 8122.
Very good. We have a motion from Ms. Marshall, second from Ms. Mock. Any further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
I believe we have all of, that was an approval, Mr. Veehan?
Yes, it was.
Yes, it was. Very good. Thanks. Motion passes. Item 2.6.
Plans and specifications for project number 787886, mill and overlay on South 5th Street, demurs to Gateway.
Mr. Walker.
Good evening, Council President, or Councilman Weber, members of the committee. This project has been proposed by the North Dakota Department of Transportation and would propose utilizing up to about $1.6 million of federal funding. Majority of the project includes milling and overlaying the existing asphalt roadway, and it also includes about a half a block of reconstruction near Demers Avenue, and then the block from 1st to 2nd Avenue would be a panel replacement project. The city share of this project is about 11% of the project costs. Total cost is estimated at about just a little bit under $2 million. So the city share on that is about $228,000. Project is scheduled to be bid February 7th at the DOT in Bismarck. And we would be back before you on the next committee of the whole meeting for approval of the bids. Construction of the project is scheduled to take place this summer. It's on that basis we would recommend approval of the plans and specifications for the project.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Walker. Motion from Mr. Weigel. Second from Ms. Mock. Questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
We'll assume that was also an approval, and motion passes. 2.7.
Plans and specifications for project number 7956, ADA sidewalk curb ramps on Washington Street from Hammerling Avenue to 8th Avenue North.
Again, Mr. Walker.
So this is another project being proposed by the North Dakota Department of Transportation. This would include replacing all of the curb ramps along that stretch of Washington to make sure that they are in compliance with ADA requirements. If you may recall, Washington Street, this stretch of Washington Street was milled and overlaid back in 2018. They couldn't complete the design work of the ADA ramp, so it's coming forward now at this time. The city's share of this project is about 10%. Total cost is estimated at about $668,000, with the city's share being about $67,000. This project will also be bid at the DOT on February 7th, and we'll be back before you at the next committee of the whole meeting for award of bids. Similarly, construction is planned to take place this construction season as well. With that, we would recommend approval of plans and specifications.
Motion from Ms. Marshall, second from Mr. Weigel. Comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion passes. 2.8.
Plans and specifications for project number 8166, 2020 water main replacement.
Good evening, members of the council. This project consists of replacing the existing water main on North 4th Street from Gateway Drive to 8th Avenue North. The existing cast iron pipe was installed around 1900. Replacing this pipe is going to help prevent some ongoing maintenance issues with that aging infrastructure. An alternate bid is going to be included with the base bid to extend the project from 8th Avenue to 7th Avenue if the bids received are low enough. Funding for the project is from 5300 Waterworks Fund, and currently there's 650,000 budgeted. The project's scheduled to be bid on March 2nd, and construction will take place this construction season. With that, staff would recommend approving the plans and specifications for project number 8166.
Very good, thank you. Motion from Ms. Mock, second from Mr. Weigel. Questions or comments? Hearing none,
Mr.
all
Weber?
In favor? Yes, Ms. Marshall, please.
I just was struck that we have pipes that are over 100 years old. Is that common, and do we have a lot of pipes of that age throughout the community?
There are some, I believe. I couldn't speak to the exact linear footage that's left remaining in town, but yeah, some of the older areas of town have their original pipes still, and the intent of this project, we kind of do it yearly, is to address the ones with problems, historic problems, and get them switched to something more current that'll last longer.
So would the plan be to eventually replace all of those pipes with PVC?
I believe so. I mean, eventually they will deteriorate to a point where we would need to replace them, so that would be the end goal.
Thank you.
Mr. Phelan.
That's a very good question, just because I was in Public Works for a little while. Some of the worst pipes were actually weren't the oldest, and so if you go back 100 years, a lot of that construction was probably better than things that happened in the 1950s. And so a lot of the water main replacement focused on kind of an era post-World War II, where some of the materials weren't as good. So we've done a lot, just so you know, sometimes the year of something, it's almost like a house. Sometimes the older the house is better built than something that was built circa 1970s. So just so you know, they kind of weigh what's going on from a water main break to the material and those sorts of things. So sometimes it's just how things were manufactured at points in time in our history. And we know now that, you know, plastic pipes are the mainstay, but when metal pipes were being placed in the ground, there were eras where it wasn't manufactured very well. So just so you know on that.
Very good. Any further questions? All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. 2.9.
Award bid for project numbers 8116, 8117, and 8118, 2020 sanitary sewer water main storm sewer repairs.
Again, Mr. Lieber.
Good evening. Bids for this project were received on January 13th with a low bid of $289,684 submitted by Taggart Contracting. The scope of this project is the annual maintenance and emergency repairs on our sanitary sewer water main and storm networks. The intent of this project is just to have a contractor available for when those problems arise and repairs are needed. And with that, staff would recommend awarding the contract to the low bidder, Taggart Contracting, for project number 8116, 8117, and 8118.
Motion from Ms. Mock, second from Ms. Marshall. Further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Thank you. 2.10.
Engineering agreement for project number 8048, reconstruct North 3rd Street, demurs to university.
Mr. Walker.
So this project would include a total reconstruction of that section of 3rd Street and would include curb extensions, ornamental street lights, decorative sidewalks, ADA compliant curb ramps, and other streetscape features similar to what was done last year on downtown demurs. This project would utilize up to $2,447,200 of federal funding from the Urban Grant Program. If you recall, the Urban Grant Program was a program that just recently came out several years ago. The agreement before you would include the preliminary engineering work necessary to do the initial surveys and the environmental documentation, and then would also include the final design work. So it would include preparation of plans and specifications and basically everything that's necessary to obtain a bid from a contractor. Normally, preliminary engineering and design engineering is not eligible for federal funds. Typically in the past, we've paid for those as 100% local expense. But under this program, we're told that those expenses are eligible for federal funding. So the intent is that we would use federal fundings for the work of this contract. Now, with that in mind, the DOT has prepared the scope of work and prepared the contract and negotiated the fee for this agreement. Based on very preliminary cost estimates, we think that the cost of this project is around $3.5 million. The federal funds are capped at they're capped at $2,447,200. The funding for the local share would come from the Street and Infrastructure Fund, and construction is anticipated to take place during the 21 construction season. The last thing I want to point out is that the agreement, the cost of this agreement exceeds what we had budgeted in 21 in the Street and Infrastructure Fund. So the intent to cover the overage would be from other projects that are budgeted in that fund that would either overrun, or they would be projects that we wouldn't pursue this construction season. So we would fund it with that. But if there were the need for additional funding, we would propose a budget amendment. So my recommendation is that we amend the staff's recommendation to include a budget amendment for this project. So with that, we would approve, staff is suggesting that you approve the preliminary engineering services agreement with CPS in the amount of $631,955.92 and approve any necessary budget amendment for the project.
Thank you, Mr.
Weigel. Move approval.
Have a motion from Mr. Sandy and a second from Mr. Weigel. Any further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. 2.11.
Engineering services contract with AE2S for project number 8199, 2020 wastewater treatment plant facility plan update.
Ms. Parvey.
Good evening, Councilmember Weber, members of the committee. This is something that we looked at last year during our budget planning process, and we identified that we needed about $10 million in capital needs for the facility itself. So we wanted to step back a bit, look at the facility and the process, biosolids management, code compliance requirements, emergency generators, blower improvements, operational safety, and really look at what we needed to do over the next 5 to 6 years and how we could fund that and what our priorities were, especially with the industrial loadings. We want to make sure that we have the capacity and the treatment as well for the long term for our community. So this plan would be able to help us make some of those decisions and really make smart decisions as we move ahead.
Any questions or comments? Yes, Mr. Weigel.
I'll just ask we recuse Jeannie and Ken.
Okay, so we have a motion to recuse.
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Marshall. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Very good. And with that, Looking for questions or a motion? We have a motion from Ms. Marshall, second from Mr. Weigel. Further questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Motion passes, very good. And 2.11.
2.12?
2.12, thank you.
MPO skewed intersection study.
Yes, Ms. Kuba?
Good evening, Ms. Councilman Weber.
Good evening.
Members of the council. Back a while ago, we kind of brought forward some information about a study that we've done along Gateway Drive. It's basically from North 20th Street to North 3rd Street along Gateway Drive. Basically, we were looking at the prevalence of crashes, the railroad tracks there, and the intersection skews that are happening. There's also opportunities for pedestrian and bicycle improvements, as well as taking a look at how well transit conditions are going through the area. As you can see, we are gaining traffic in that area. It's especially those truck movements, and they are going up north on Washington as well as north on Mill Road. They are, you know, so those capacities are growing and increasing, and so we're just trying to get a handle on all that. As you can see, and there you can see that the traffic is going to be increasing. Our models are showing by 2045 it should be increasing between 7,000 and 10,000 cars per day. That number does get reevaluated every 5 years with our long-range transportation plan. One of the other things that we were looking at as well is we took a look at the existing traffic controls, did an analysis of that with the existing and how they would be viewed in the future as well. In this, as they exist today, the North 20th Street signal is not warranted under the conditions that it has today, as well as the North 3rd Street. Although we do know that there is Wilder School there, so that's one of the reasons with the into the future, it's still potentially needed as being there in the future. As things stand today, with nothing changing in the future, that's not the case with North 20th Street. All the crashes are, you know, there's injuries, there's right angle crashes, there are rear end crashes. And one of the reasons we're having some of these crashes is a lot of these unsignalized driveways. People are trying to get in, trying to get out, trying to be there. Most of the time on a road this heavily used, you're looking at wanting only a very few number of access points. Here we have a lot of them, so that's adding to the increased crash rate, especially in there. I mean, we've got some, you know, 17 crashes in between 20th and Washington in the last 5 years. Most of those are because of long queues and density between spaces. And we do know that it does get backed up because of the train as well. One of the reasons why, as you can see, there's 50% of rear end crashes. And so at 20th Street, and that's mostly because there's a lot of distance between Columbia and 20th that's pretty much free flow. There's no turnoffs that anybody can use to get anywhere, so everybody's speeding up, and all of a sudden they're slowing down at the light because of turns and traffic movement. Washington, we have it's heavily truck related, freight related. Eight of the crashes involved trucks. You know, there's 45 crashes in the last year, 5 years. We aren't having any pedestrians or bicyclists involved, but we'll get to some of the reasoning behind that too. Once again, this is, you can see at Mill Road and Fifth, there's been 41 crashes in the last 5 years there as well. I mean, we're looking at a section of road that's basically very high crash related. Some of the good points is that there haven't been any crashes whatsoever at the rail for the railroad, but it's still considered high, you know, fifth highest in the city and seventh highest in the county for probabilities of it, of a crash happening, just because of everything that's going on in that section of road. We're looking at, you know, train blockages, you know, 4 to 5 times per day, roughly. We're looking at, you know, most of those trains going 10 miles an hour or less. And then there's the possibility of the unit train. So it's just that, that is, you know, that's the biggest concern of all, is that that unit train for that area. It will, if a unit train comes through, it will cause an extra 10 to 17 minutes of delay for everything. And it's no longer maybe 4 or 5 crossings being blocked. It's going to be from the rail yard all the way to the mill that it's going to be blocked at times. We looked at the bicycle and pedestrian network. You know, we're looking at, there's, you know, ADA issues of, there's that, you know, lights in, you know, light poles in the middle of the sidewalks. You've got trying to cross, you know, at the railroad tracks, things like that. Not as many actual pedestrian crossings, as well as there's no actual signals for pedestrians to cross. So there's all those issues. And then the bicycle network, we have the multi-use path that goes behind most of the businesses along Gateway. It does become a danger for crossing at Mill Road and at Washington at that, for that multi-use path. There's also, all, you know, we, it's, you know, basically we, you can ride your bicycle on the sidewalk, but if it's not ADA compliant, so a wheelchair can go through there. I don't see how a bicycle could be very comfortable doing that. And while bikes can go onto Gateway Drive, not many people are feel comfortable enough or are experienced enough to actually use that road. Basically, our transit network, that they're doing okay. They haven't reported delays in their schedules for trains of any kind, but with longer trains in the future, that might be a possibility. So we took all of this information and we asked our consultant to bring forward as many possibilities as they possibly can, so that we can present them to the public as well as our steering committee. So here are some of the possibilities. These are the ones that are more favorable, or more possible, I should say. The three along the top are pretty much without any kind of realignment or anything like that involving the railroad. It's just trying to either, all of the plans have in the top left-hand corner there, all the plans will include this basic improvement along the road. It will hopefully reduce the number of crashes along there, as well as being able to have additional safety for pedestrians along that way. The other two on the top there are more, while they include those safety things in the first one, they also try and help with the turning movements for the skew. Some of them are very hard to turn, especially for large trucks. You're getting farther out into the intersection, and so trying to maneuver that is not very comfortable, or you can't get as many vehicles through because of the waiting traffic. The three on the bottom all include a realignment of the mill spur going up, and for those for the railroad to use the Glaston, which is along 42nd, and then crossing back over and then coming back down to the area. It's not just the mill. The mill does have a lot of trains, but there's also a few others that are in that area. We also have a few other ways, as we said, some of the access management, trying to work with all of the businesses that are along that corridor to try and work together using similar openings, shared openings, driveways and things like that. If we can't get a realignment, you know, or it takes to get something like that, doing ITS rerouting, allowing people to know at various key points along the road, so that they can, letting them know that there's a train on the tracks so that they can make a decision ahead of time. If they're going east, something at Columbia or 20th. If they're heading west, something in East Grand Forks, so that they can route themselves downtown or a different way. Some of the alternatives that were presented, we have suggested eliminating for the simple reason they're expensive, they're not really desired, especially in the case of a grade separation. If you can't realign the whole mill spur, you can't really converge roads or anything like that. Also the bottom two there, they don't actually make any improvements. They actually make things worse. So that's not the objective of any of the studies that we do. We did present all of these alternatives to our steering committee, which included our North Dakota DOT, Grand Forks Engineering, Grand Forks Planning, the State Mill, as well as BNSF, and a couple of businesses along there, a Near North neighborhood member represented them as well on our committee. So they were our experts and wanting to know what was desired. So that's some of their input as well. But we also presented to the public, and they did have a very high preferral of one of them, one of the alternatives, and many of them really liked the idea of the realignment for the simple reason it goes beyond just, they could see the benefit beyond just the corridor that we were studying. Anything beyond that corridor we were studying, we have no quantifiable facts about that. So it was an existing footprint with the railroad realignment was one of the favorable ones. As I said, the grade separation is not really feasible. A lot of money, a lot of people being bought out and things like that, as well as, you know, access management. While not many businesses are favorable to that, they want to keep their access as much as possible, and we can understand that. But we really want to encourage them to work together and have a solution, because I'm sure they don't want people getting hurt just to get into their businesses either. Let's see here. Specific feedback we got was, you know, the realignment, once again, neighborhood would prefer the realignment. Some of the takeaways, you know, I kind of went over some of those main takeaways, but as I said, we do look at our traffic forecast quite often, every 5 years. And this is the main one that everybody was looking at and was desiring. And so it's basically just realigning with the existing footprint and trying to get some of that bike and ped facilities put in, as well as getting some, limiting the amount, trying to limit the amount of crashes along the way through access management, being able to move things around. You could, if you tried some of these things and got people to move, you know, use 13th as a backage road, or tried to do kind of a loop around so that people can get to the other side of the road if they needed to, or using 20th and to get into some of that north end, Norby's and the welding there. That would improve the traffic situation enough for that 20th Street light to still be needed in the future as well. So if you get enough traffic using that and more people see it and know it's there, then people will start slowing down and recognizing that they need to. We do have a very planning level, high level cost estimate. We're using North Dakota DOT unit costs, which is what they request of us to do at a planning level. And we're still looking at, you know, some of the, you know, those costs can range drastically, what some people would consider drastically, and there still needs to be a lot of refinement in that cost. That's one of the next steps, is really refining that, giving it to the engineers so that they can do that extra expanded cost benefit analysis, adding in any other types of funding or costs that it would take to actually put a shovel to the ground in any of this project. Let's see here. We do have some potential funding mechanisms that are available as well, and that we know about, and we're, as the MPO, we're willing to assist in any of the federal type funding sources that we can. There's any questions, comments?
Yes, I have some. The mill, North Dakota State Mill, is a fantastic asset for our town, but I got delayed there today. It was relatively short, but now with unit trains coming on, those delays could extend, according to the report here,
yes,
up to 10 to 17 minute delays.
Mm-hmm.
So this is increasingly something that needs to be addressed. However, the realignment of the mill spur would put additional pressure on the situation at 42nd.
Yes, and
you push down one place, it comes up somewhere.
Yeah, yeah. And there, through other plans that we've done, we have, there has been a desire known to do that grade separation there at that location, as well as the location at 42nd and Demers. Those two are on in plans, they and things like that. The only downside of that is the fact that trying to find funding to do those projects at any time, that's going to be the case.
I have not always been a big champion of the grade separation. However, if this needs to happen, would the grade separation at 42nd address the additional traffic coming in from a realigned mill spur?
We believe so, from a planning perspective.
So suddenly that becomes even more important if this needs to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about ITS rerouting?
Basically, it's basically there's sensors at the track that will start. You'll want more of a, more of a written sign, like on the, like you see out on the interstate where they say, most of the time they're just saying drive safely, but that's what this would say too, probably. But then when there's a train, you get there and it's going to say, okay, the train, there's a train here at Crossing Gateway. That at that point you can make the decision whether or not you need to go a different direction. There's also some other companies out there that also have the ability to send messages to your phone that says there's a train crossing at Gateway. So, and then you can reroute yourself from there.
I've long been excited about this possibility. I don't see how it would be as useful at the mill spur as it might be at 42nd. However, I've heard concerns about security issues, sending out that kind of information for terrorist acts or different things. How is the technology viable these days? And it was a Canadian company that this comes out of, but it can be modified to the U.S.
There's several companies out there
okay.
And that are doing this that have it available. It's just a matter of how you want to be able to set it up and how much money you want to spend to do it is pretty much the case.
Any other questions? Ms. Mock.
You had mentioned the idea of possibly sharing or combining access points.
Mm-hmm.
Is there some sort of limit or review process if you want a new access point? Does staff review that?
That would have to go through engineering as to what exactly you want, whether it's viable or not. That's one of the things that when we looked at that, it's one of the ones that really didn't perform good at all. It actually created more problems, so we don't want to create more problems.
Well, I mean more from additional access points, like what the process would be for that.
Typically what we've seen in the past on that one is we tend to go with the NDDOT local district. They end up having jurisdiction over US 2, and so we end up running a lot of requests through them. And a lot of times they try to keep the number of accesses about where they're at, keeping existing ones or combining where available. As Terry ended up mentioning, there are a number of access points along this corridor. And so trying to limit those is a priority for them.
Because the combining didn't really improve situations, but I imagine increasing the number probably doesn't help
Correct.
The situation either.
I was a little surprised to hear that the signal at 20th is deemed unwarranted. However, I'm also hearing that if things were to proceed with the mill, rerouting of the mill spur, that would then stay? We would keep that light there?
It wouldn't necessarily be contingent on the mill spur, but if you do have a reduced number of access points, you need to have backage roads or frontage roads to be able to access things. And 20th to get to 13th is a good example of doing a backage type road. To the north of there, there's the Norby's and the welding and stuff. They could use 20th to get to all of that, you know, and have a frontage road type of thing going on.
I see. So this is an information-only item tonight. We're not being asked to make any recommendations. But one of my main takeaways is that a mill spur realignment has both engineering support and support from community. Is that an oversimplification?
There are some next steps that need to be done in order to do that. We do need BNSF to come on board and do that or be open to that. They said they've told us in our steering committee meetings that it is possible, but they have not given approval one way or made any suggestions or supported anything for sure.
They're not likely to come out and say yes or no at this point, but they're not saying no at this point.
Correct.
And the mill, what does the mill have to say about this? Do they have a preference one way or the other?
They haven't said they have a preference, mostly because they have done work to land their unit trains. So they've added a lot of track in their business areas, which is one of the reasons why you see the Bacon Road crossing signs on along Columbia in a certain places, and then it has a light when there's a train crossing Beacon Road that will flash.
Any further questions or comments?
Yes. I have one quick question.
Please, Mr. Meehan.
With all of the work that was done on the Kennedy Bridge over the last number of years, did that have an impact or influence on the number of accidents along that corridor?
Not that we could see in the data. You know, we averaged it over several different months and came up with the you know, looked at what crashes happened along there, kind of looked at the averages for the blockages. So it wasn't just the years that the Kennedy Bridge was being having construction, but there was a few years beforehand as well that was included, especially in that crash data.
Okay, thank you.
And with this being a U.S. highway, how much, there was around a $7 million price tag on this. How much support could we anticipate from the feds on something like this?
On the feds, that just depends upon how you're going to use the available funding from that the state gets through through their transportation funding. There's also that build fund granting. There's prairie dog funding, that type of thing. So it just depends upon where you're wanting to shift money around. Because once again, if you take money from one thing to give it to another thing, you know, you're missing something has to give.
I suppose one other piece to that as well is a large portion of that estimated cost is in relation to that railroad realignment further north, and that might be questionable as to which programs might be able to support that.
Very good. Not seeing any other questions or comments. That's the last item on the agenda. Let's see, just further.
There's one.
Do
more,
we have
Mr.
one
Weber.
More? Yes, we do. 2.13. Thanks.
Grand Forks Growth Development South End Developer Updates.
Where's Mr. Field?
Sorry, Mr. Weber, we have one more item, which is the main event.
Also important, yes. Thanks.
Tonight, we're going to, as staff, we'll try to go through administratively as quickly as possible. But here, I want to make a note. So Ryan Brooks is going to present, Paul Hodak's going to present, Al Grasser is going to present. He's also going to introduce two developers that would like to develop in and around 62nd Avenue. I just want to point out a few things administratively, because we represent the mayor and we help him put the budget together. It's really, we want your input at the end of the day on this to make sure we're aligned with where you want to go. Number one. Over the last 5 years, we've built a new business park, which is starting to grow and be successful. We also worked with, on that, we worked with that with the Grand Forks CDC, and I see my friend Keith Lund is in the back there. Number two, we worked with the strategic infrastructure growth areas, where we invested some of our economic development monies to make sure that we had land that was available for with utilities so that we could react to development sooner rather than later. So we've done all that over the last 5 years. I think we've been pretty successful. Along the way, the state opened up this Bank of North Dakota loan program that Maureen referenced now that we're closing things out and now we have to pay back. That was $15 million. A lot of that infrastructure money was invested in these strategic infrastructure growth areas, which we paid back to a significant percentage with our economic development monies. That all being said, we think we can probably put a slowdown to that. Brian will go over some of the areas. We think we can put a slowdown to some of that activities that we've invested a lot of resources in that. We've opened up a lot of areas, and now we should just kind of let them flow a little bit. And most of those are centered on the western part of the city and along Gateway Drive that have driven some good business. And as I think Council Member Marshall, you said to me one time recently, are we ever going to be done with Oscarville? And we've put a lot of money into Oscarville from an economic development perspective. Al will say we still need to put a street in there, so we'll see how that goes. But we'd like to slow that down. That's one policy decision you should weigh in. We think we can slow that down a little bit. Number two, we've heard it's great that we're developing downtown. How do we develop infill development throughout the city of Grand Forks? And we should put a focus on that. We should be more proactive, and we should do things we do downtown throughout the city of Grand Forks. So we think that's a number two thing that we should do as we move forward. So Paul and Ryan will speak of that. The other thing Mr. Weber has been really involved in is the regional market capture committee, and that was really meant to be an infill development technique for business. So trying to balance that. So we're trying to really develop citywide with our infill, so we'd like some input on that as we move forward. And then one of the things I really want to highlight is we've gone through, people have asked what are the additional tools that we have that can move the needle on infill development. Paul's going to talk to you about, we found one with a commercial remodeling exemption that there's some opportunities for you to engage from as policymakers, maybe to move the needle a little bit on that. I want to if you can focus on that third one. And the fourth one is the South End development, which is a really big deal. This is a big deal because when we jump 62nd, that means we're gonna invest a lot of money. And that's where the city kind of wants to go. And so Al is gonna lead a conversation about, one is on the north of 62nd, west side of the levee. Councilmember Marshall, right in that area where we're going to have some meetings, should we further develop in there? And then south of 62nd, that's more of a discussion of, we're going to have to invest a lot of infrastructure money into that, and what do we want to do? Developers are here, they have some plans, so that's going to be kind of exciting to see that. So with that, we'll be as quickly as possible. Really, at the end of the day, we want to get to the end so we can get your feedback on those four or five policy areas. So with that, I'd hand it over to Ryan to kick us off here.
All right, thanks, Todd. Let me get this full screen here. Oh, right in front of me. Thanks, Dave. Thank you. As Todd said, we'll be brief. So if we go too fast jumping ahead on something, feel free to stop me and let me know. We want to start off first with the $1 billion map. You guys have all seen it, but we're all really excited about it. We want to kind of start with everything that's going on. So I'm not going to go through each one of those, but there's a lot of things going on in Grand Forks. This is going to talk a little bit about the infrastructure that we've had to put into place to allow that $1 billion map to be $1 billion. So this area here shows the SIG areas where we've put infrastructure. That's to make that shovel ready land for primary sector. And you'll see us kind of building this map. So we also have some residential edge development that's gone on. Hopefully it shows up a little bit better on your screen, but there's dark blue areas that have been happened in the last 2 years. So that's 2018, 2019. Those are areas that have been filled in with residential. There's multifamily and single family in those. In addition, you'll hear two areas that are going to be coming in here shortly. Those are those yellow areas there. Those are areas that are being requested. Two developers are here tonight. In addition, the green dots that you're seeing here, the remodeling exemptions that have been that have come in, and that's just 2019. So that's happening everywhere throughout town. Those are residential and commercial. In addition, we have new and expanding business exemptions that have been coming in. Those are those big yellow dots. In addition, we have two TIFs that were downtown in the last couple years. These are adding in, the blue dots are adding in all the TIFs that have come in since 97. With that, I want to kind of, that map there kind of shows everything kind of layered in, everything that's going on in town. We want to talk a little bit about the tax incentives overview. This has been presented, I think, a couple years ago. These are the incentives that are allowed through North Dakota Century Code. They're discretionary in nature. We have local options as well. Then you can kind of see some of the areas that purposes, some examples that are there. I won't go through all of those. We have our REN zone. This is the geography map that goes with that. Those are the areas that are allowed, most of it being downtown. We also have our three block island out there by the Grand Cities Mall. Those are eligible as well for REN zone. We have three in reserve, and those will be inputted in our next update. That's the water treatment plant area up here that we've kind of held in reserve, waiting for that. This is not obviously meant for you to read, but this is our Renaissance Zone incentive summary. This is what we hand out to developers. That shows that essentially the city has maximized that ability of the REN zone as allowed for in state law. Click out of that. In addition, I'll get into the TIFs. The TIF program is allowed for in Century Code, Urban Renewal Law. Typically, they come in two forms, bonding and exemption. We focus on exemption. It's a lower risk for the city. And the key there is the city provides no funding to a project. I think a lot of people assume that we're giving cash away on these deals, but what we're doing is we're exempting the owner from the new taxes on that increment that by them providing that investment, we forego the taxes of that new. And we often like to show these examples. So I'm kind of showing the University Flats example. And it's a little hard to see, but that came in 2016. So we're out in this area here. In the next couple of years, we're going to actually start to see some of that tax. And if you remember what that looked like at the time, there were homes there. We're still receiving the taxes just like those homes were still there. But what we're foregoing, instead of them paying taxes like when the building went in, the value jumped up to here. We're just seeing a delayed benefit to that new value coming in. So that's why we think it's such a great program in terms of foregoing our taxes that we normally would have collected on that new investment. So it's a investment by the private developer, and the cities and the other taxing entities are delayed. And I do want to point out too, anything over 5 years, we do have to go through that local government advisory committee as required by state law as well. Another program, the city has not taken advantage of this like some other cities, but there is also something called a payment in lieu of taxes pilot program. That's something that we have been looking at developing policies on. We have some examples there of areas that that have been discussed that would perhaps be ripe for that, vacant and bank-owned commercial properties. So malls, hotels, there's a couple bank-owned hotels out there, some operating and some not, that seem to be prime candidates for that. UND mixed use development has been discussed as an area, as well as regional corporate headquarters, all being categories that have been discussed and other communities are using pilots for those. With that, I'll turn it over to Paul to talk about the exemptions.
Thank you. Very quickly, I was just asked to go over some of the exemptions that our department offers. We have, I'll be discussing the builder exemption, the new home exemption, and the commercial and residential remodel exemption. Also, I have a comparison up here. You can see how we do it and how other cities do it. I'll start with the builder exemption. The builder exemption is an infill or a greenfield development eligible. It doesn't matter where your new home is built. If it's an existing neighborhood or in a newly annexed area, it would qualify for the builder exemption. The builder exemption exempts 100% of the building value for 2 years as long as it's owned by the builder and remains unoccupied. After the builder exemption expires, if the property sells, then the new homeowner would qualify for the new home exemption. The new home exemption exempts $150,000 worth of building value for 2 tax years. So there's potential for new homes being built, either infill or greenfield development, to have an exemption in terms of the builder and the new home exemption for 4 years. These exemptions are maxed out by state law. We do everything allowable by state law. There's nothing more we could do here without a legislative change. Just so you can see in Grand Forks, we do the max that's allowed by law. As I said, Minot, Bismarck, Dickinson, and Williston don't offer any builder exemption or new home exemption. In West Fargo, they offer a 1 year builder exemption for $150,000 only, and then a 2 year new home exemption. Fargo and West Fargo both do it that way. So in terms of the builder and the new home exemption, again, we're doing everything we can that's allowed by state law, and we're doing more than any of the other major cities. So that's the new development, the new homes in a nutshell. Any questions on those? Yes.
The 2 year exemption on new home development, is that a delayed exemption or is it just a free and clear 2 years of no increased taxes?
It exempts for the new homeowner or the builder?
For the homeowner.
It exempts $150,000 worth of value.
And that doesn't come due later on. It's
correct.
It's exempted
correct.
Forever.
It's completely
okay,
exempt forever. Well, for the 2 years, it qualifies you. They don't have to pay it back. Right. Okay. On the residential and the commercial remodel exemptions, here's where I think we may have an opportunity to enhance those exemptions. As I look at it, the minimum for a residential remodel exemption is $5,000 or 10%. So if you increase your value by $5,000 due to remodeling, we would send you an exemption application. You submit it. It gets approved by the city council, and that exemption is 100% of the value due to the remodeling is exempt for 5 years. We have no maximum on the residential remodel exemption. On the commercial exemption, it's very similar. It's a minimum of $5,000 again, but the maximum is $1 million. This maximum has been in place for a long time. I don't really know where it came from. It's not a state law. The state law has no maximum in place. Other cities, Fargo, Minot, Bismarck, West Fargo, all offer some level of remodel exemption, and none of them have a maximum. As I look over the course of the last 10 years and commercial remodel exemptions that have hit our $1 million maximum, there's been 10 of them. 6 of those were retail buildings that were being redeveloped and renewed. The top 2 were large retail buildings that got renewed, and if we hadn't had that maximum, the top one would have seen another $2.8 million worth of value exempted for the 5 years, and the second one would have seen an additional $2.1 million of value exempted for the 5 years. And in light of the retail situation that we have with vacant retail buildings, I think now would be a good time to take this opportunity and remove that ceiling. It's not required by state law. It's not done in other communities in the state. And if you were so inclined, I think we could do that to create an opportunity for us to incentivize further development on these large commercial properties. My best recommendation would be, I think the minimums also need to come up. We have a $5,000 minimum. Again, this ordinance is about 15 years old, and that $5,000 minimum is awfully low. From an administrative standpoint, it makes it very difficult for us to even hardly dare make a change to the property. We are very aggressive in sending out those remodel applications when we see one that we think will qualify. We do send them out without someone coming in to us and asking for it. That's another difference between our department and other departments in the state, is we actively send them out, whereas in a lot of the other cities, you don't get the opportunity for the remodel exemption unless you come to us. So we're a little more active that way, and I'd like to see, you know, maybe the minimum go up to, like, I'd say at least $15,000 increase, and then potentially remove the ceiling completely on commercial. Any questions on that? If
Ms. Bach.
Is that something that the work you're doing with the chamber, if that were a concept, is that something that committee would talk about and see if that is of value to people who might be interested? And, you know, what thresholds might be appropriate to look at?
It has been part of that conversation, yes.
Yeah. I could work with the city attorney and the city administrator, and we could make some recommendation as to how we would have to pass a resolution adopting the new guidelines.
Hey, thanks, Paul. As Todd Mr. Phelan mentioned earlier on, we've got some presentations here. Good news is we've got a couple of developers that are interested in pursuing some development in Grand Forks. You've just kind of seen all the different programs that we have going on, supporting all kinds of different infill and commercial growth and different things like that. So this kind of fits into, I think, that holistic program about trying to provide everything you need to make a community work. So what I'm going to do here is I'll introduce here the two developers, and then when they get done with their presentation, I'll come back. I'll talk about a couple of the specific challenges and the processes that we have at each of the locations that they're talking about. So with that, I will introduce the two of them that will show up will be Zach Bopp and John Lowry. Zach will be talking about the North Side 62nd Avenue development, and Mr. Lowry will be talking about the south of 62nd. So those are kind of the two general areas that, again, we'll be talking about. With that, gentlemen.
Good evening, Council. My name is Zach Bopp with Midwest Planning, and I brought also the developer, Mr. Jackson Mason, of Mason Custom Homes. First, I just want to mention too that we both lived in this community for many years. We've worked in this community for many years, and we take great pride in how this community has developed over time. So, we just want to provide a little insight into this development here. Just want to be able to pull up this, just hit the next one over. This layout here just kind of shows a general overview of the concept, anyways, that we're showing right now. Pretty generic detail right now, obviously, pretty conceptual at this point. But we want to show out, obviously, proposed roadways, land use types. The yellow up there, that's the R1 zoning is what we're proposing. The red is R2. We're also showing the stormwater ponds and the park district dedicated property as well. The intent of this development is to provide single family lots with frontages of 85 to 100 square 100 feet and lot sizes of 12,000 to 15,000 square feet. The R2 designated areas are proposed to allow the developer the opportunity to have the diversity in the home types while also maintaining the overall quality and look of the neighborhood. The developer's intent is to have the lots available for home construction by the fall of 2021. To meet this goal, construction of the underground utilities to serve this area would need to begin by the fall, this fall actually, 2020. We understand to meet this goal would take a lot of work, and working with the city engineering department to meet the master planning requirements and the city planning department to meet all the zoning requirements. Construction on the west side of the levee obviously will bring additional steps and challenges, but we're willing to work with the city staff to make all parties involved satisfied. The reason we are here tonight is because we believe this is a need for this type of development within the next few years. As the staff report indicated, there's a limited availability of future single family lots in the next few years within the current city boundaries. Without new developments like this one, this availability will soon be exhausted. So we want this development to meet the future demand and continue the growth of the city. Thank you. Any questions?
Yes, Ms. Marshall.
Yes, I'm wondering if you have any projections on the price point for the homes that would be developed in this area.
From what is in the current neighborhood right now, we're projecting, you know, from 400 on up, just because of the current area, we want to try to keep with what's there and meet that.
Thank you for your time.
Oh, I thought that, okay, now we're going to hear the south side of 62nd, is that correct?
I think it's two both developers and
then now. All right, great.
I met Mr. Lowry coming up to talk about the south side.
Yeah, good evening, Councilman Weber, Council. Thank you for the opportunity to meet with you this evening. My name is John Lowry. I live and work in Fargo, North Dakota, and am working with the Johnson family on developing the property that is located east of Washington and south of 62nd. The two Johnsons that I'm working with, they own the northwest quarter and the southeast quarter. And then there's other relatives that inherited the northeast and southwest portions. So we'll come up with a catchier name for then Johnson subdivision, I promise, along the lines. But at this point in the game, that's where we're at. And, you know, I have a number of slides here. I wanted to get a 30,000 foot overview of the entire project. And I'm probably going to speed through quite a few things. So, again, if you want to stop, please do feel free to ask questions as we go through here. So so this is an overview of the overall project. As I mentioned, Washington and 62nd, it's just southeast. You'll notice there's a little white spot. There's a couple, 2.5 acres or so chunk that is not owned by those property owners. I believe it's one of the initial farmsteads on the property. But the overall project represents, and I'll go into highlight some of the specific areas, but we are proposing some PUDs or some dimensional standard amendments basically to the existing zoning ordinance. We're looking at some maximum setbacks rather than minimum setbacks, creating some density, rear alley access, open space. You'll see quite a bit of parks and open space throughout the subdivision when you look at it overall, and creating cities are finding that by creating density, getting more people per foot of road that they put in the ground, it's got a better return on the investment that the cities are making. We're conscious to that and trying to work with, you know, modern zoning practices to incorporate that into this subdivision. So coming off of Washington, you'd have a main corridor that would have an urban feel opening up to a mixed use space and park, and we'll get into that as we go. So the red areas, north is to the left of the page here. This is your traditional commercial developments. You're seeing your two-story office buildings, some urban contemporary styles, your strip malls. These are the developments that are being proposed fronting Washington primarily. You know, how far back on east on 63rd that goes, your hotels, your other retail space that's being proposed. So this is your general B2 district. The B2 PUD, this is where you get into the maximum setback rather than the minimum setback. And in this space, that's fronting that main entrance into town, into the development, excuse me. You'll notice as well on the south side or bottom of the page, we're creating kind of a landscape buffer there. We're trying to buffer the traffic and create pedestrian-friendly areas within the subdivision. So this is where you're going to see the shopping district, live, work, play type feel. Here are some of the developments that have been done in recent, and there's some credit, photo credits throughout. You can see where those come from. But you're more of your mixed-use development that would front that corridor and front that park space. And I'll get into that in a minute as well. The R4 PUD, that's a modified at R4. You're also dealing with some of the maximum setback. That's where we're talking a multifamily high density, but creating something that has a mini mansion type feel. It's not the traditional 24 or 36 plex with two entrances at each end of the building and common entrance. You'll have, you'll make it look like a house, but there might be six units on that individual entrance as they stack. Continuing on, the R3 PUD and the R2 PUD, difference being the densities, but this is your traditional like brownstone look that you might have. And anybody that's been, you know, Denver, St. Joseph, Missouri, Springfield, other areas throughout the Midwest and your more urbanized areas, this is what they're moving to. It's, you know, your rear entrance, alleyway, garages, and pushing people out there, getting them out in the front yards and along the approaches. So here's some different pictures from different areas. You know, you can get as fancy or as simple as you want with these. So the R2 one and two family, I'll kind of speed through this. This is your typical construction that you're already seeing in town. Along, you'll notice along the perimeters, we can't really incorporate some of the back alley entrances efficiently. And then, you know, as we go to the east, away from the high density areas, we're trying to transition into some of the more traditional single family, one and two family homes that you've seen in other subdivisions in town. So your fourplexes, duplexes, and single family, on down to your, so your R2 PUD, this would also be the alley entrance, similar to what we talked about, just a little bit lower density as we transition to the east. And here are some examples of that. So all the way down to your R1, that is very typical of what you've seen, some of your higher end homes. The lots do vary to the south, they're maybe 60 foot in width to get your price point a little bit lower. And then you know, some of the areas are that upper end, you're seeing 400,000 and up. So some more examples and screenshots of that. So I wanted to highlight the parks and open space. So this is the park that's at the entrance. It's actually, I think there's a place up in north of Seattle that's similar to this, but also in Colorado and Denver, when they abandoned the airport, they incorporated something very similar to this that we used as inspiration. But you'd have a stage or an amphitheater, carnivals or you know, weekend sales out in that space. And again, surrounded by that mixed use downtown building with open space in the center to focus on. So we're really excited about the opportunity that that brings. Then as you move to the Eastern Park, this is your more traditional park space. We would propose some stormwater detention and water quality on site. And then a portion of the park worked out. We have begun conversations with the park board and they do have space to the north, but we're working with them on limited improvements in the space and more open space to count towards park dedication requirements. And then you'll see the connectivity. That's a huge piece of development today, creating outdoor spaces and connection between them. And so we propose those spaces in multiple different ways between side yard bike paths, rear yard open spaces and bike paths, and the connection to the main park amenities that exist throughout. So I do have some information on typical sections. One thing that's unique is that east-west corridor, you'll see in the red at the west end, then the orange, then the blue. That is really intended to maintain that open feel. The red is a downtown with perpendicular parking off of it, so you'd have street parking. As part of the development, we would also have cross parking easements for parking to the rear of the buildings, the mixed use development, as we move forward to get those people off. But then the orange area is actually a one way. You can see that 130 foot right away with pedestrian trail then is the blue area to the east. and you'd have a nice wide median with trees and expanded space for people to get outside and have picnics and do different things, so, and enhance that pedestrian connectivity. Bike lanes throughout at those key connection points as well. So that's everything I had. I'd be happy to answer any questions or that you had this evening.
I got to tell you, I was so prepared to not like this, I find myself kind of excited about it. However, I'm still concerned. It's on the wrong side of 62nd, and maybe I need to be corrected on this. But we've got our infill development. If it's north of 62nd, we're doing infill because we have the infrastructure in place to accommodate this. South, this becomes sprawl. Now it's just one side of the street and the other side of the street, but there's expense for the city. It's very different going south of 62nd than north of 62nd.
Yeah.
Although as sprawl goes, this is the kind of development that we need. Yeah. Like you're not even putting in much bike infrastructure because you don't need it because people can bike on almost all of this. I mean, it's already bike infrastructure. I would hope that we would extend public transit out there because a lot of these people, if they had access to public transit, wouldn't need a car in this kind of community.
Yeah.
Right.
So I'll defer to the core infrastructure discussion with the city engineer, but I will say, the developer has been very patient. The property owners, excuse me, have been very patient. We reached out to the city in the summer of 2018, I believe it was, to have some discussion about the potential for this property. And they said, let's pump the brakes a little bit. And this last fall, we reached out again and said, hey guys, where are we at? We're willing to be patient and do this right as we move forward. They're excited. You know, they want to partner with the city and put forward a project that's just not all about money, but do something that's nice and has a legacy to it. So I think those are the type of individuals that the city wants to partner with. And, we get it's not going to happen overnight. So the other point that I was going to make, if I can get back to my overview, this isn't going to happen. I apologize. There we go. So this isn't going to happen in 5 years. We get that. So the proposal would be that we'd have this main intersection off of Washington, the east-west center one, and then right between the purple and the single family, that access would be built out. With that, the stormwater ponds would be constructed. There's a sanitary force main in the south ditch of 62nd today. A new lift station would need to be constructed to tie into that. And then water, I believe this is in rural water service area, but water is at the northwest corner of 62nd Washington and could be extended down. This is within the levee system as well that was constructed. So your key pieces are there, and when the timing is right, are ready to move forward. So,
thank you, Mr. Larry.
With that, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Mr. Grasser, school me on this here.
Everybody's touched on a lot of things in here. I'm just going to swap in case I need to talk about, point to anything in the discussions. There we go. Part of filling in here on the infrastructure components, a lot of it has been mentioned. When we look at the start out here on the north side, 62nd Avenue, a couple of the things that we will be dealing with out here have to do with the fact that it is on the wet side of the levee. Some of the policy and discussion issues we'll have with the city side is that there's a strip, 140-foot wide strip here that the city actually owns, came back to the city as part of the taxes, part of the annexation and tax special assessment processes that occurred quite a few years back. We'll need to think about how what to do with that and or how to incorporate that into the subdivision. But really this one, other than that, doesn't really have any big trunking infrastructure needs. There's a sanitary sewer lift station nearby. There's some, basically the underground gravity is there. The trunk thing, so to speak, will probably be the regional stormwater system that'll have to go in. But again, lots of discussions, I think, to be had on the flooding component of it. How do you protect it? Those types of things, because it is on the wet side. We have two different things. We don't really have it up here. Some of the early development on the north side of Adams Drive there were larger lots, single family, and those homes were elevated pretty high. Some of the subsequent ones, the lots started getting a little bit smaller. If you remember from last year, some of the flood discussions, you know, the homes may be protected to 54-ish, 55 different elevations up there from the flood, but the roads themselves are down there at about 50 feet, and that's where some of the problems come in, is that the roads maybe go underwater before the streets do. On the southerly end, you know, some of the discussions have been, clearly we need a lift station to serve that area. We're on the outside of the lift station service boundary. Usually we put a lift station so that it will serve basically a section of land. It's kind of the most efficient layout that we have. So this lift station would end up kind of going in the bottom, the southeast corner of the subdivision layout that you just got done looking at. The forest main would go north to an existing forest main on 62nd. We have some of those costs tentatively laid out on your staff report. More than likely in this area, what we've been doing is going with more of the interim lift station concept, which would be about $1.6 million. The reason for that is with a service area as large as the entire square mile section of land, you know, to build the full lift station out this early, you know, for an area that might take whatever 15 or 20 years to develop, you know, it seems like a phased approach might is a better cash flow expenditure. And we did that a lot of times on the strategic infrastructure growth areas, some of the same concepts, and we put in some interim lift stations instead of the full-blown, just recognizing build out's going to take a while. Force main cost is in there. Force main, I think we'd build that to the proper size right on the get-go to make sure we have that. Otherwise, it's very hard to go back and rebuild those once the homes and everything are in. Stormwater pond, there's a city share that goes into a stormwater pond if they meet certain criteria and size. At this point in time, we're not positive, but we think we'll probably need a new drain area out to, for this section of land or components of this section of land, out to the river. We're evaluating some of the, working with them, developing, looking at the pipe sizes and things like that to figure out if that investment needs to be made or not. At this point in time, we're kind of assuming it does. Don't know how much, exactly how it would be configured. And again, then the last thing in there, just noting the city has a cost share on collector roadways. Traditionally, that would be something like Cherry Street, or in this case, maybe Cottonwood Street, extending down to the south. There would be a city share for that. Oh, the other component that does come into play on both of these is as we've been growing south, one of the things that we extend is the water, the potable water, fire protection for these areas. And we've had a relationship with Rural Water for a number of years, and they're looking at wanting to maybe change that relationship about how the city grows into those potential service areas of theirs. So I know Mr. Meehan, Mr. Phelan, and others have been having some other discussions with them relative to what might be the new agreement or the new paradigm that we work with Rural Water in some of these areas. So that'll take a little bit of time. Procedurally, one of the next things that would happen is that a lot of the next steps would go to the Planning and Zoning Commission. You need to have approve a concept development plan, of which some of the things you saw are pretty close to that. That would be a run through. Then you've got the approval of the actual plat, and then there would be an annexation that would go along with that. Those things usually then go directly from Planning and Zoning straight to the City Council and not the Committee of the Whole. And we just thought with given some of the new issues and new areas that we're talking about, we wanted to have this come at least as an information item at this point in time to the Committee of the Whole. It's information, no action at this point in time, but there will be some decisions that we'll be needing to work through later. Any questions?
Exciting stuff. Any questions? Anyone? Very good. Ms. Buck, yes, please.
How does this, either of these developments, relate to our long-term planning for the fire station? And does that, I mean, when we talked about the fire station, we talked about that lasting 40 years into the future. How does this type of development at this point in time stress that?
Defer that to Fire Chief.
That's a good question. I don't know that I have the exact answers without taking a look at distances and travel distance. You know, these developments are going to take years to start to build out, and so you start to talk about what are the trigger points that would talk about moving fire or locating a fire station down that area. I think it would probably be more prudent to look at the location of all the current stations to make sure that relocating a station wouldn't be more beneficial than adding a station. I think it would take into considering what's going to happen on I-29 if and when the 47th Avenue interchange were to happen, and what type of growth would happen there, and how that all develops at the same time, so we can plan long range out rather than just keep adding stations to make sure we have the ones that we currently have in the best locations. Right now, I'm not overly concerned about that with the type of risk down there, but I would want to look at that a little closer.
Because from a financing standpoint, we reserved 4 mills for several years, and then that rolled over to the cost of the staff that then filled it, correct? How many years did we reserve those mills?
Ms. Mock, members of committee. So how that was structured was the actual construction of the fire station was paid for with cash funds that we had set aside. But for ongoing operations, we had built in, we didn't raise 4 mills, but we set aside. So we're operating using that ongoing equivalent to 4 mills for the increased cost from that.
So. And how long did you plan for that?
That's ongoing, so.
Yes, but I mean, before it was built, how did you reserve the cash?
We did that over a 4-year period of time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that was about 4 mills you were setting aside during that time?
Yes, yes. What we ended up doing is, over that 4-year period, but the plan had been to increase 1 mil a year for 4 years for a total of 4 mils. What we were able to do is only increase 2 mils, and then the final 2 years, although we allocated those additional 2 mils, we did not need to increase mils, but we did set aside over a 4-year planning period for that equivalent.
Great question. I just assumed that station number 5 was going to be able to cover these. What I'm hearing is we don't really know right now?
No, I would want to look at that a little closer to see what our travel distances are and see how far out that gets. That is getting out there a ways. But we'd have to look at some data to see, you know, when you guys feel that it's kind of time. You have to look at, not just because there's a few houses out there, I think you need to look at the risk, and then you all of a sudden, you know, what type of risk, and then the demand for service. If you have a call every 3 years, does that warrant putting a fire station out in that area? So we need to look at all of those things combined to see when that trigger point would be.
It isn't just a matter of putting a compass down and looking at the distance.
Well, you can do that. That is one way. ISO, the Insurance Service Office, kind of uses a mile and a half polygon as one way when they start to measure fire distance. But if half of that mile and a half polygon is a golf course where there's no demand for service, it doesn't make any sense. So if you can kind of correlate all those things, if you look at just the risk, what type of risk, and then the dollar values associated with those risks. But then the other side of it is, once you start to get some development in those areas, your demand for service starts to climb, and your responses are starting to get longer. It pulls units out of one area into another area because of that. All of those things combined kind of add up to when we should look at a fire station in that area. Now, there's no industry standards of what those are, but if we start to look at what we're averaging in the rest of our areas, you start to see that trend going upward, you know that it's going to continue to rise, and that's when we need to start to move. But again, I don't think it just means let's
upward
just keep
in terms of response times.
Yes, we don't want to start just plopping fire stations. We need to look at the overall picture and that how development is progressing, and maybe we can relocate a station and cover the area well without just keep adding stations.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, thanks. So this was information only. Basically, you're looking at, do we think this is a good idea, bad idea, general green light, yellow light? Certainly a clear sense of where we're at with fire protection. Some other of those infrastructure questions, not infrastructure, but service-related questions. But speaking for myself, overall, this sounds like a... Yes, please, go ahead.
Ms. Weber, Ken here. Question for Al. What did you, again, would you repeat the process that would typically naturally go on from here? You said the next step would go to planning and zoning. Would you just review that one more time, that process?
Yes, Mr. Dean. Again, and I'm skipping out a lot of steps. I mean, some of this ends up going back into city budget considerations and things like that. But one of the next official steps that would traditionally happen would be the concept development plan that would go to planning and zoning in the plat. And under those scenarios, that's usually where engineering then asks, the subdivision master plan or the master plan basically for that area. And that gets into, starts peeling the onion, so to speak, as to what we need for infrastructure. This one, again, has got a couple of twists and turns concurrent or maybe even preceding with that. We're talking with the developers. We need to really look at the storm sewer, how that entire section of land is going to be served by storm sewer. Again, it was laid out at the way it exists today. There's some ponds and things out there that were laid out under the flood protection project, but of course the need in those areas for flood on the flood protection project were different than what we're going to need when we start doing the full build out relative to how full can the ponds can be, how long it takes to drain them out, things like that. So that I think is going to be one of the bigger challenges out there. It reminds me a little bit of back in the days when we started first contemplating the South End Drainway, and you know, how do we, when we break into a new area, how do we get drainage? And sanitary sewer stuff is relatively straightforward. You know, it's square blocks that you're building. Essentially, there's dollars associated, but the storm sewer gets a little more complex. But unless the city council wants,
on this one,
coming back, there wouldn't be any immediate trigger, I think, to the city council in the near term.
Mr. Vian?
Yeah, I guess what I was wondering, because that, you know, once the developer starts the concept plan, it kind of gets the ball rolling, which is typical, and it would be good. The question I think we need to know is comprehensively, what does that mean for our growth? First of all, identify clearly the need for growth in these areas, but also what does that mean for cost, especially long-term operation and maintenance costs? Because it sounds like there's a fair amount of total infrastructure going to be necessary, and of course we worked a lot in the strategic growth areas to be prepared for that. A lot of that was, you know, from a business perspective, but we've not really looked at what we're going to do for housing. So it would seem before we get started too far down the road, we would understand what the true implications are to sanitary sewer, wastewater, stormwater, street and highway arterials. All of that is going to need to come together as we kind of cross these boundaries that have been existing for quite a while. I mean, crossing 62nd takes us into a whole nother level of development. And so although the concept is good, I guess the idea of what the true impacts to the city are, the city would be. And then the other thing is from the Metropolitan Planning Organization standpoint, is this where we are going to grow next?
Mr. Veen, there's nobody here from the MPO at this point in time, but it was one of the areas, as I recall, on the long-range transportation plan, and again, even in our local plan, some of the next tier of growth would be pretty much immediately adjacent to 62nd Avenue South, would be one of those identified residential areas.
Mr. Grasser, would the interchange on 47th and Interstate have any impact on these development proposals?
Nothing really jumps out at me, you know, because that would be, you know, a mile south of 62nd Avenue. There may be some interplay, especially on traffic and as it may relate to an inner city bridge, but I'm not prepared to address or really speculate too much on it. Nothing really jumps out at me in that regard.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Marshall.
Yes, and I think that this kind of maybe mirrors or adds on to Mr. Vian's concern. These are interesting looking projects, and I think that you know, we should take them through the process and consider them and do what we can. I like the fact that this development that's proposed for south of 62nd has a variety of different types of housing, not just single home residential. And so that is an attractive feature of it. But looking at the bigger picture of housing in Grand Forks, it would be helpful to have some information projections on the type of demand for different kinds of housing at different price levels and throughout the community as a whole. And, you know, I realize that's a lot of projection, and I don't know how close to accurate that information can be, but if there is information, say through community development office or other resources, to be able to kind of get a real high level view of what the needs in Grand Forks are, at least as we know them now, understanding that as you build, people will come too, so that's a factor you maybe don't can't project. But additional information on needs would be helpful.
Yeah, those are good, all good comments. Again, I think the path could be somewhat variable, but one potential path would be that, again, when the concept plan comes in, I said essentially you saw really a concept plan already in there, but some of these questions, I think we can work with bringing those questions in at the planning and zoning level. Final approval of all these things eventually come back to the city council, so it may be such that, you know, I think there's going to be an interplay between how much gets addressed in the planning and zoning level. If there's still some questions on the city council when it comes back to us, there may be some additional, you know, I'm not suggesting that it goes planning and zoning and city council approves it right away, you know, the next meeting. This is a more complicated question, and there may be some more time between, you know, when some of those approvals are received.
Good. Ms. Mock.
When did we plan for this area in the land use plan? Was this in the next stage? I can
cover that. Thank you.
So, and thank you for your comments too, Ms. Marshall, because a lot of what you talked about is things that we cover in our land use plan. So this was the next tier. So we have a three-tier system, and this is that next year is to jump 62nd, and actually, if I'll just quickly point out, the edge of where we're looking at here is Merrifield. That's our flood protection limits that Al actually covered earlier for other reasons. But you know, there's always a fear of, you know, how much further south are we going to go? Well, once we get into this mile here, then we're heading west. So you know, in terms of whether or not this is the right area. We had a, I know for sure we were looking at this tier being our next area. So, and I know John has, Jonathan Lowry has looked at that plan. He probably knows that about as well as anybody in our office at this point. So I think he's taken a good amount of time looking at that, because a lot of what he looked at, the way he designed, was a lot of the things that we put into that plan as well. So. That's correct, yeah.
I think we wanted, just so you were aware, that it is a big policy step to move forward. And so as administrative staff, we're taught to get to yes, find a way forward. And so we will continue to take your feedback like we got tonight, and we will work to try to find solutions when we bring it back. So we just wanted to make sure we didn't bring solutions back and you guys weren't prepared for our solutions. So I think with that, I think we have enough and there's more time to go. And I think the developers have heard you're receptive enough for them to move forward, and the details will matter as they come forward in the next few months. And so we'll take that attitude.
Anything else? So that's 2.13, information only. Other business from any committee members? Announcements, no announcements tonight. Looking for a motion to adjourn. Motion by Mr. Weigel, seconded by Ms. Marshall. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion adjourned. Meeting aye. Adjourned.
Thank you for being with us tonight. This meeting has been brought to you in part by...
Let Grand Forks International Airport help you start your next vacation off on the right foot. Grand Forks International Airport offers flights to the sunny destinations of Orlando, Las Vegas, and Phoenix on Allegiant, and connections anywhere in the world through Minneapolis-St. Paul on Delta. Forget the hassle of long drives, parking nightmares, and stressful check-ins. The convenience of flying locally means less headaches and more time for you. Grand Forks International Airport. Your airport. Simply grand.
What's up? Sure, be right there.
When a ringtone comes between you and your day off, at least there's satisfaction in knowing that while you're away, you can keep the best brand name tools at your fingertips. Like Honda and Alcoa. Not to mention, of course, DeWalt. That way, work gets done faster, and what you left behind doesn't have long to wait. Load up today at the guaranteed lowest price, only at Home of Economy.
You know what we think a lot about? Energy. Clean energy. Smart energy. New energy. All kinds of energy. But, you know, the safe kind. That's why at Xcel Energy, we're using future stuff like drones, AI, and virtual reality to make the future of energy cleaner, less expensive, and, you guessed it, safer. For you, for us, for everyone.
Work. There's all kinds. There's the work we do in the morning. The work we do in the dead of night. Problem-solving, world-changing, mind-bending hard work. It's what drives us to lead the way, unwilling to quit. Because the work we do, it's bigger than us. It's work worth doing.
Live it up. Every day you wake up singing. Turn it up. The party's just